this week we've had the conference of an EU project. It's the final conference for an EU project which we've had running for the last 2 years, which has involved partners from Denmark, the Viking Ship Museum and the National Museum of Denmark, and SP Tritech in Sweden, the Dutch Cultural Heritage Agency, and GIOS in Denmark. And the project has been about the spread and outbreak of shipworm in the Baltic and the threat they pose to underwater cultural heritage, such as shipwrecks and submerged Stone Age sites. This week we've had 1 day conference where there are about 15 lectures, people from Greece, from Italy, all over Scandinavia and from the UK, talking about their experiences with the problems of shipworm in their countries and how we can develop methods to actually see where they're potentially spreading in the Baltic, using various models to try and understand the temperature and salinity and oxygen in the water in the Baltic, how that's affecting. And then we've had a workshop on the Tuesday where people had the chance to look at various aspects of the project. So we had people looking at methods that we've developed and used to protect shipwrecks so they could see those. They've been able to actually look at shipworm themselves under the microscope. And shipworm aren't the only things that degrade archaeological wood. There's bacteria and fungi that also degrade archaeological wood underwater. So they've had a chance to see those kinds of bacteria. And they've also had the opportunity to look at the model, the computer model that we've developed to see how the environment in the Baltic is changing and how it may change in the future.
So it's important that you take the surface layer and section inwards. And then to start with, I think you should practice on this wood. This is 1,500 years old and it is totally degraded. I'm cutting with a razor blade on this. And please be careful. So plutselig, så ser du et eller andet spændende.
So you'd have the four anchors fixed first, and that's very important to have them fixed. What you then do, there's a draw string, correct me when I'm wrong, Bob, which you just pull, and it removes the white net, which you can see on there.
Yeah.
And then the net's ready to roll out.
This is the full size of this.
This is the full size one, and you just join them.
Mm-hmm.
And then what's really smart with the system is that these fronds are, what are they, about a metre and a half?
A metre and a half, metre and a quarter high.
And a quarter high. So these are the plastic fronds which divers could easily get stuck in, but they're all held down by this black net, so when you're finished the diver then just removes the net. And then
what we're doing a lot of at the moment is where they put rock or concrete blocks or sandbags, they've put a heap of sandbags. What we're finding is they get edge, what they call edge scour, because it's a hard surface, and we're putting our mats around those edges to soften the surface and allow it to the sediment to deposit in a softer surface.
They were developed for the offshore industry, covering pipelines, cables, and certainly the footings for.
So these have been prepared for when we're doing the diving part of the training school. This is a standard sort of length, 3.5 meters. We've made it to 6 meters length. And the idea is that when you've rolled it out, we bring it back a little bit so that it gives it a possibility for these buoys. We've got small fishing buoys on there to get it buoyancy.
Have the netting a typical mesh, or are there different ones?
There are different ones. So this is a debris netting. Marcin has mentioned there's a shade netting, like on the inside of greenhouse.
Nets, you have filtering nets for water, especially in the Asian countries, they make it. Which is very strong and fine, looks a bit like this.
As long as they have their siphons, their breeding organs or feeding organs above the seabed, they can bore down in a piece of wood down under the seabed as well.
And how long can they get?
I don't know. I think at least a couple of, about 10 or 20 centimeters or even longer down in the sea.
It's a piece of a frame from the ship. You can see where the planks would sit.
And here you can see from this species, the true shipworms lining the burrows with calcium. You can see trace left behind here, but no alive individuals inside. It's only the
last 2 days we've had a small group of divers who have been part of the conference, from Holland, from Sweden, and from the UK. And they've been actually out on the water with us just in Roskildefjord, trying out some of the methods that we think are suitable for protecting shipwrecks in situ. And that's what we've been doing this week.
Vores deltagere skal lære, det er jo forskellige metoder til at sikre vrag på havbunden. I går der prøvede vi med to forskellige metoder. Dels med sandsække, og så med nogle store stykker stof, der hedder geotekstil, som vi har lagt ud over stammebåden.
So what we're going to do now is first David is going into water just to make a few photos and films. Then
I'll go in
and right after you all three.
Okay.
Go in to look at the sandbags just to see how it's been laid down. Do you think they have to rearrange?
Or like Heather's done on the starboard side, if we move them all sort of 90 degrees.
Yeah.
I'll roll it over the wreck side, fix it, and then meter by meter.
Nice. Yep.
Martin told us you had to start with geotextile.
You see? Maybe we should just put the other on another.